Welcome back students to the video lecture series. I am Adil Mansoori from Civil Engineering Department of LJ Institute of Engineering and Technology. So my dear students, in the previous video we discussed regarding the physical parameters of water. What should be the different physical qualities of water before supplying into the community, okay, and what should be their permissible limits, right? So let us now start with the next topic, that is the chemical properties or chemical parameters. Okay, so the first one that we will discuss today is the total solids, right? So these solids include the solids in suspension, colloidal or in the dissolved form, right? So in water they are either in suspension, right, or in colloidal or in the dissolved form, fine. Then the quantity or suspended solid is determined by filtering the sample of water through the fine filter, drying and weighing. Okay, then the quantity of dissolved and colloidal solids is determined by evaporating the filtered water, which is obtained from the suspended solid test, and weighing the residue. Fine. The total solids in a water sample can be directly determined by evaporating the water and weighing the residue. Okay. High solid contents indicate either contamination or presence of excessive mineral matters. The amount of total solid should preferably less than 500 ppm. Higher amount of solids are likely to produce psychological effects on human systems. Okay. Now, if I talk about the environmental significance, dissolved solids may impart color, taste and toxicity to water. Right? We all know that. Then, some of the dissolved organic constituents have been found carcinogenic. Carcinogenic means they are responsible for causing cancer, right? Then degradation of organic matter may impart objectionable smell. Clear? They can be removed by tertiary treatments like reverse osmosis, that is RO plant which we all have in our houses, then electrodialysis, distillation, ion exchange process and zeolite process. So all these processes are utilize in order to remove total solids. Okay, let us talk about pH. So we all are aware about what pH is, right? So it is defined as the negative logarithm of hydrogen ion concentration in water, right? So it is a measure of degree of acidity or alkalinity of water. And it is measured on pH scale, which varies from 0 to 14, right? So we already are aware that if the pH value is between 0 to 7, then the water or any fluid is tends to be acidic. And if the pH value is between 7 and 14, then in that case, the particular pH of the sample is basic, right? So if pH is equals to 7, then the sample is neutral. Clear? So pH can be taken as negative logarithm of hydrogen ion concentration, or we can say log to the base 10 1 upon H plus, that is the property of logarithm. So H plus ion concentration should be 10 is to minus 7, therefore pH will be equals to log. In place of H plus, I have written 10 to the power minus 7. So log to the base 10 into 1 by 10 to the power minus 7. Or I can write it as log to the base 10 into 10 to the power 7. Right? So it is the property of log again. So pH will be equals to 7. Clear? So what are the methods of measurement of pH? So first one is known as the colorimetric method, and the second one is known as the electrometric method. Let us have a look at each of these in detail. So the first one is the colorimetric method. In this method, the chemical reagent or indicators are added in water, and the color of the solution produced is compared with the standard color of the known pH value, right? Then these standard colors may be in the form of colored liquid in glass tubes, colored glass disc, or colored charts supplied by the manufacturer with each indicators. Okay, for acidic range, the common indicators are thymol blue of acidic range, benzol blue, methyl red bromophenol blue, etc. And for alkaline range, the common indicators are thymol blue, alkaline range, phenol red, and toluol red. Okay, so next is electrometric method, right? So in this method, a pH meter is used. Okay, we will see when we do practical in the laboratory. The sample of water is kept in a beaker of which the pH is to be measured, and the two electrodes of the instruments are dipped in water connected to a dry cell. Okay, the current passing through this circuit indicates the pH value, which is read directly on the dial. Okay, there is a screen. So if we place the electrode and when we pass current, then it will show the pH value on the dial. Okay, or it will display it electronically on the dial. Okay, the pH meter is standardized by buffer solution of pH 4 and 9.2 before using. So if I talk about the environmental significance, then for potable water, pH of water should be between 6.5 to 8.5. Very low pH may cause corrosion or tuberculation. And very high value of pH, that is alkaline water, may shut biological activities. Okay. Let us talk about acidity. So it is the capacity of substances to neutralize hydroxyl ions, that is base. Okay, so we all know that in water there are two ions, that is H plus and OH minus ion. Agree, right? Now there, if the solution is basic, then it will have OH minus ions more, right? And the capacity of neutralizing these OH minus ions will be because of H plus ions, right? So that particular capacity of those substances to neutralize OH minus ions is known as the acidity, right? So it is due to the presence of minerals and dissolution of carbon dioxide. So there are different types of acidity. Let's talk about mineral acidity. So it is due to presence of minerals like sulfur and iron pyrites, number one. Then its pH range may be between 0 and 4.5. Second one is known as the carbon dioxide acidity, which is due to dissolution of carbon dioxide in water from the atmosphere, right? And that range may be between 4.5 and 8.5. Acidity is measured in milligram per liter of calcium carbonate. Clear? So it is the unit in milligram per liter of calcium carbonate. Clear? So talking about environmental significance, acidity interferes in the treatment of water, as in softening. Presence of acidity causes the corrosion of metals and pipelines. Industrial waste containing acidity and alkalinity must be neutralized before they are subjected to any kind of biological treatment, right? Because we just now in the previous slide saw that if the pH is more or less, then it will be hindering the biological activities, right? Let's talk about alkalinity. So alkalinity of water is a measurement of its capacity to neutralize acids, that is to absorb hydrogen ions without significant pH change. The alkalinity of water is due to the presence of caustic alkalinity due to hydroxyl ion, that is OH minus, and carbonates, that is CO3 minus 2, and temporary hardness due to bicarbonates, that is HCO3 minus. Okay, the alkalinity is usually divided into two parts: total alkalinity, that is above pH 4.5, and caustic alkalinity, that is above pH 8.3. Clear? So if pH is less than 4, then there will be no alkalinity. If pH is between 4.5 and 8.3, then it will be due to HCO3 minus ion. If pH is between 8.3 and 10, then alkalinity is both due to CO3 minus 2 and HCO3 minus. And OH minus and CO3 minus 2 together give initial pH of 10. Clear? So again, as the acidity was measured in milligram per liter of calcium carbonate, same unit of alkalinity is also there, that is milligram per liter of calcium carbonate. Clear? So application of alkalinity data, that is first one is the chemical coagulation. So chemicals used for coagulation of water and wastewater react with water to form insoluble hydroxide precipitates. The hydrogen ions released reacts with the alkalinity of water, and thus the alkalinity acts to buffer the water in a pH range where the coagulant can be effective. Alkalinity must be present in excess of that destroyed by the acids released by the coagulant for effective and complete coagulation to occur. Okay, what coagulation is the addition of coagulants, right, in the sedimentation tank, so that all those suspended matters which are of minute size, which are lesser in size of few millimeters or lesser than few millimeters, right, which cannot settle in the settling tank, right, under the effect of gravitation, then the addition of coagulant is done so that they will combine and settle down and pure water can be obtained. That particular process is known as the coagulation. Clear? So next is water softening. So alkalinity assists in finding out the quality of lime and soda ash required for removal of hardness. Then corrosion control. The natural waters are sometimes rendered alkaline to control corrosion due to acids. Then excess alkalinity is harmful for irrigation, which leads to the soil damage and reduce crop yields. The large amount of alkalinity imparts a bitter taste to water. Okay. Then highly alkaline water is usually unpotable, that is you cannot drink it. The water, the wastewater containing excess caustic alkalinity are not to be discharged into natural streams or sewers because it will hinder the biological processes. The water having alkalinity less than 250 mg per liter is desirable for domestic consumption and also for RCC construction. Okay, so let us move ahead with the next topic, that is the hardness. So hardness of water may be defined as the soap destroying property of water. Okay, so whenever you are trying to work with soap, right, it will not be able to produce foam, right? Sometimes it is possible because the water is hard, right? And usually this hardness is due to the presence of minerals. Okay, so at those places where the water is obtained from underground wells which are at a shallow depth of around 50 to 60 feet or even up to 100 or 120 feet below the ground level, then in that case water is usually hard, which leads to reduction in the formation of soaps, right? That is the foam. Clear? The hardness may be of two types, that is temporary hardness and the permanent hardness. So the temporary hardness is due to presence of carbonates and bicarbonates of calcium and magnesium. It is also called carbonate hardness, and it can be easily removed by either boiling of water or adding lime to the water. Okay. Then the permanent hardness is due to the presence of sulfates, chlorides, nitrates of calcium and magnesium. It cannot be removed by boiling and requires special treatment. Okay. For example, zeolite or soda lime process. And the permanent hardness is also known as non-carbonate hardness. Okay. The hardness is measured in milligram per liter of calcium carbonate, same unit as that of acidity and alkalinity. So talking about the environmental significance, the hard water causes excessive consumption of soaps in laundries, right? Then hard water forms deposit, that is boiler scales, in boilers, right? Then groundwater is generally harder compared to the surface water, as I said in the beginning of this hardness topic. Clear? Then the prescribed hardness limit for public supply ranges from 75 to 115 ppm, that is parts per million. Okay, so let's have a look at the classification. So if the hardness of ppm, that is in milligram per liter of calcium carbonate, is less than 50, then the water is considered to be soft, right? Then if the hardness is between 50 and 150 milligram per liter, then the water is considered to be moderately hard. If it is between 150 and 300, then it is known as hard water. And if the hardness of water is greater than 300 milligram per liter of calcium carbonate, then in that case it is considered to be very hard water. Okay. So my dear students, that's all for today's video. We will discuss some of the chemical properties more in the next video.